take your places tonight. You find them quite full in the end. What I'd like to do is start off with a couple of members and a couple of visitors and faces here. Perhaps don't know everybody else, so I'd really like us to start off and introduce ourselves. So first of all, extend a warm welcome to Councillor Ian Byrne from Liverpool. It's lovely to have you here tonight. So I am Councillor Doughty, chair of pension fund in Merseyside, and pleased to be in the town hall. So over to Colin.
Colin, who is this?
Adrian Jones, a Wirral
councillor. Ian Byrne, Liverpool councillor.
Cllr Pat Cleary, Wirral councillor.
Councillor Pat Cleary.
Councillor Andrew Gardner, Liverpool councillor, as well.
Catherine Hodson, Liverpool council, councillor Ward.
Councillor
Chapel,
Patrick Ward, Liverpool councillor.
Brian Kenny, Councillor for Pittston and St James of Ward.
Councillor Pat Hackett, Wirral Council, New Brighton Ward.
Councillor Sally Jones, Wirral Council, New Brighton Ward.
Peter Warwick, Director of the Pension Fund.
Roger, would you introduce yourself, please?
Roger Bannister Hughes.
Right, so welcome everybody to tonight's meeting at the Pensions Committee. Have you got any apologies at all? So we've got apologies from Paulette Lappin. So Paulette is the representative of Settlement Council and she's almost always here. So, great, okay, well we'll start on with tonight's meeting.
Chair, Dr. Eileen Williams and Sarah Rulskiller.
So where's Sarah from?
She's the
which union is she from? Right, so thanks for being here tonight. So we're just going to go, first of all, any declarations of interest. So normally this is where we declare if we have a personal or pecuniary interest, perhaps we or a member of our family are members of the pension scheme. So first of all, Sherry.
My daughter's a member of the pension scheme.
My wife, Paul, is a member of the pension scheme.
Member of the pension scheme.
Okay. If I draw your attention to page 11 in the first instance, just a reminder that from an audit perspective, the Audit Risk Management Committee of Wirral MBC were altered their charter of governance in terms of respect to the pension fund financial statements, but we have determined that the Pensions Committee is the appropriate committee to communicate with, given your roles and responsibilities of the fund. But ultimately, because of the Wirral Council Paul Park statement of the Council of Wirral, they will ultimately be their charter of governance. If I take you over to page 12, just flags the on your packet, it's page 4 of ours. The key impact we've assessed as part of our work on the fund this year and the drivers of our consideration of risk. Hopefully these are fairly consistent or understanding from you as members. In terms of any guaranteed minimum pension, I know there's been a lot of discussion around that, and though you've got a couple of items on the agenda today around the clouds and elements like that. Currently we don't believe the GMP would be an issue for the LGPS. I think it's in the HF Treasury's review of equalisation and equal cost of funds generally, but we will have to keep a monitoring eye on that. We are aware that the pension regulator is taking a much greater interest in the administration of funds and certainly in the data. And I suppose in a way, again, on tonight's agenda, we were highlighting pooling as an issue. I know you've got an item again on tonight's agenda. I think for this year's accounts, because of where transfer of funds are, it's not going to have a direct impact on our 18-19 accounts, but clearly we will keep a look at that. And also picking up, we've had a couple of new funds come online this year around the strategy that again will become part of our audit. So that's where we're sort of looking at the overall fund. And I'm conscious we have got some new members on it. We then move on to pages it's 13 and 14. We then identify those into the risks we need to look at after the audit. I think as most members have been before aware, there's two risks that I cannot read that I need to look at in terms of they are simply risks under the standards, which is revenue recognition. We can rebut that for the pension funds, your main income comes from contributions and investment income, which we can track. And then the second one is management override and controls. And we've looked at the arrangements we've got in place for the funds. We can't rebut that. That assumption, but what we will do is primarily driven around journals around in terms of the way that the management could potentially manipulate your accounts. So I'll just think of the risks, we're going to rebut revenue recognition, and we recognise management override control as a good risk, and we will be focusing particularly on work in those areas. Turning over the page, the other significant risk we've identified is in relation to valuation of assets. We will be undertaking work, so we will be looking at all your assets, evaluating all of your assets. But a specific significant risk in relation to level 3 investments, which by their very nature, from an audit perspective, they say they don't have observable inputs, so I can't easily go to financial time or anything like that and get a figure, a quoted price, and then see that that agrees with what you've got in your accounts. There's an element of judgment within these, either that be by valuers or by investment managers themselves. And as a result of that, we identify them as a significant risk because if those valuation judgments aren't right, then potentially there's a material misstatement in the financial statements. So we have identified those as a significant risk. We've outlined there the specific work we're doing to address that risk. So those are the key risks we've identified on page 15 of the other matters in relation to being a public sector body and opportunity relative to objective accounts. The reason we're going to concern is slightly different when you look at pension fund because it's affected by the wind-up, but not in wind-up, the LGPS itself is not in wind-up. We still need to undertake some work of your cash flows, but the risk is definitely reduced in relation to individual pension funds. So then that in a way leads on to page 16, materiality. As I say, we've set materiality for the audit in terms of the way to make sure that we can give a true and fair opinion and also an efficient audit. In the past, we related that to net assets. We see no reason to move away from the benchmark. So again, we've set out or determined our materiality to be £85 million this year, looking back in terms of where your financial statements are on net assets. And that equates again to around about 1% of your actual net assets at the end of December. Again, there's no change to our approach from last year. We have determined we don't need to set any specific materialities for fund accounts.
relatively trivial, and I know that's trivial in the sense of the auditing perspective, not trivial in their sums themselves, is just over 4 million at 4.25 million. So we will only report back to you on that. On page 9, just like the audit fee, there's been a reduction this year with regard to the PSAA contracting. There's about 23% reduction in relation to that. We do undertake some work around giving assurances to other auditors of bodies within the scheme in respect of IS 19. I can't tell you exactly what that figure will be, but it has so many people write in. I wouldn't expect it to change simply from that, but we are in ongoing discussions, especially around some non-profit organisations. And then finally, on page 19 of your pack, just a reminder around independence, we can confirm that we do remain independent of the fund itself. And I think on the very final page, which I'm not going into detail, if you hear us talk about slightly different methodology this year, we're using the Cllr, which is a change to our methodology. You shouldn't see any change in the from your perspective, but there might be some tweaks in terminology, so we put an appendix in there around what we might hear from us going forward. So overall, that's kind of this year, and I'm happy to see comments and questions.
So members, if you have questions on our auditor, so it's obviously we're coming to the point where we've got the evaluation that's been completed. The purpose of the evaluation, whilst helping everyone, is to very much really determine the employer's contribution moving forward. So it's of great importance to our employers, our local authorities, and all the other employers in the scheme that we keep costs as low as possible. In order to do that, we need to make sure that our valuation is as accurate and as meaningful as it can be moving forward. So we're grateful for the work of our auditor and obviously for our financial officers. I know we've been very busy, and I've been talking to some of the staff in World Council in the payroll sections and the like, getting the information ready, getting it as accurate as possible. So very grateful to our auditors in preparing that for us and moving forward. So we're happy to note the report unless there's any additional questions. Thank you. Okay. So, on to agenda item 4, which is our local government pension scheme update, which, as usual, will be given to us and spoken to through by Yvonne. Hello. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. This report updates our focus on the cost management process and the impact of the planning. Section 2.1 refers to the dual cost management process in operation within the LGPS. This is undertaken by the scheme advisory board. These mechanisms ensure that the cost of pensions is retained within an agreed range. GATS review of the 2016 valuation found that the scheme is below the target cost of 19.5%. And to bring the cost back in line, the scheme advisory board has proposed a number of improvements to the scheme in the face of April. These are listed at 2.2 of the report. I'm sure you've noticed there is a just disjunction of banding, which is a typo. Band 2 should start from 12851 and not 12501 supported in the report. This is expected that the proposal could increase the employee contribution rates across the scheme by 0.9% of pay, and the impact on employers will vary because of individual member profiles, and this will also be dependent on the 2019 valuation. The remaining paragraphs the cost management process and the benefit changes have been paused. This is because the government has lost the McLeod case in the Court of Appeal, which has an impact on the cost of pensions. And this case relates to protections given to members of the judges of five ISIS schemes who were within 10 years of retirement in April 2012. The Court found that these protections were unlawful on the grounds of age discrimination. Consequently, the government has applied to three courts to appeal the decision. Although the case is lost, younger members who are being discriminated against will need to be offered improved benefits. Despite the case only applying to the judges and firefighters, as all the public sector schemes provide the protections, it's likely that the outcome will apply to all schemes and indeed the LGPS. In light of this uncertainty, staff is consulting on the approach to be taken for the 2019 evaluation, and it is understood that staff will direct their
ultimately that the councils and employers will pay that. So whether we agree with the finding or not, that's the recommendation. So you've asked us to note the reports and the recommendations. Are there any questions? No? Very good. And agenda item 5, Yvonne, you will talk us through that as well, please.
Thank you, Chair. This report comes from consultation issued by New Fair Deal relating to revised pension protection for LGPS employees. This consultation opens on the 10th of January and closes on the 4th of April. And the fund's draft response is attached to the report. This is the second consultation on this matter. The first one was in 2016. Section 2.4 to 2.9 refers to the proposed changes and informs members of the latest consultation seeking views whether to remove the option of a broadly comparable scheme. It also proposes that all employers will be considered as fair deal employers, with the exception of further education bodies and admission bodies. There is a new concept of protected transferees, who are members employed by a fair deal employer prior to transfer, who will be given access to the LGPS. There's also transitional arrangements which cover staff who have already been outsourced, defining them as protected transferees when services are going to be retented. It also proposes that service providers don't need to become admission bodies, as the outsourcing body can take on the role as the deemed employer and pension purposes, even though they're not for protocol purposes. The admission body groups will remain an option. Fair deal employer chooses that the contractor should access the scheme as a standalone employer, and this approach may be more appropriate for larger contracts where a service provider picks up all the pension risk and not being passed back to the employer policy. Scheme advisory boards will issue guidance to assist employers to address pension risks when outsourcing contracts and to consider whether the admission body or the deemed employer use is the best approach for that particular contract. Section 8 notes that the proposed removal of the broadly comparable option will help to maintain LGBT membership levels and will dampen the pace of scheme maturity. The fund response to the consultation agrees with the overall policy intent and indeed the employer route where contracts are constructed on a pass-through basis on the proviso that staff will issue statutory guidance. We have highlighted that the main impact is for employees, that the fund role will be to ensure correct administration processes are in place to implement the fair deal decision on the approach whether to go down the ET's approved or the issues. And our recommendation is that committee members note the scope of the consultation and provide approval for the submission of the fund response to MHCLG by the 4th of April. Thank you. Happy for any questions.
Members, if you've got any questions,
yeah, can you just talk about what the fair deal is?
Sorry?
Fair deal.
What is it?
Yeah.
Fair deal is a central government directive and supplies for central government departments and academies that when they are outsourcing services to private contractors that they are asked for membership of the public sector pension schemes. It doesn't apply to local government. Because that was up there, that was considered under the best farming and transfer direction, which was in 2007, and this is an update to superseding the best value direction for LGPS, so
there is a recommendation in this report, and also for us to approve the response which everyone has put together on behalf of the fund. So in principle, we understand and we agree with what the consultation is about, what we're trying to achieve, obviously. So happy to approve that report and for Yvonne to send the response off to the government. Okay, thank you. Right, our next agenda item 6, is over local authority pension fund conference, and Peter's going to introduce the item to us.
Thank you, Chair. Member development is an important element of membership of the Pensions Committee. The PLSA Local Authority Conference is one of the headline events of the year. This year it's from the 13th to the 15th of May in Gloucestershire. And section 2, I set out some of the content of the event. It's discussing particularly the fact that it's a triennial evaluation year this year, and there's actually going to be a move to a four-year valuation cycle, some discussion of the cost cap, and also potentially the forthcoming pensions dashboard. A number of speakers too, including the Minister for Local Government. The fund has been represented at all previous PLSA local authority conferences because it's a worthwhile event. The recommendation is that committee considers if it wishes to send a delegation, and if so, to determine the number and allocation of places. And I certainly encourage members to attend the conference. There's a more detailed agenda set out as an appendix to the report. It covers both pension administration and pension investments, and it's also an opportunity to network with other LGPS funds.
So if I can really emphasise the fact that, as Peter said, you know, sometimes when you come to the pensions committee, you haven't got a clue what we're talking about. And I've been in the pensions committee now for, how long have I been here? 5 or 6 years? 6 years probably, as a member of the committee chair for the last couple. And I'm kind of just getting to grips with it. And this is my last meeting. So, it really is important that we try and engage in conferences and training events. So even though you might feel, you know, you don't want to go to a conference because actually you don't know what on earth you're talking about, it does come after a while, and you do meet like-minded members and funds from around the country. So it is a good training opportunity, and there's some very good speakers and topics being discussed at this conference. Now, I know for Wirral councillors that the dates for this conference clash with their making and different things. But I don't know if you're able yourself from Liverpool, Councillor Byrne, to attend, but if anyone wants more information, then Roger, you might go along as well, I don't know. But Emma Jones will send information out, and I think we're in agreement that any members wishing to go to this event are more than welcome. It's usually attended by the Chair and Vice Chair, but let's get along and represent ourselves if we can make it. Great. Any questions over that? It's in a nice hotel in Gloucestershire, and the food is always okay. It's a bit fancy for my taste, but it's a good event and some good speakers there. So, right, okay, we have risk management, which Peter's going to talk us through, agenda item 7.
Thank you, Chair. This report builds on the reports I brought to last committee around the appointment of a framework of investment managers providing equity downside protection strategies. And as the executive summary indicates, I'm seeking approval firstly to implement the strategy outlined in the report for Mercer, which is part of an exempt appendix. And then secondly, I'm seeking to add some wording to our investment strategy statement, which explicitly allows the use of derivatives. So under section 2, set out the background. As I mentioned, I brought a report in January, and along with the work with the actuary and with the fund's major employers, we've been putting the necessary plumbing in place with our custodian, so that we now have collateral account, and we've transferred, or in fact, all being well, on Wednesday, we'll be transferring collateral to that account, so that's in place as and when required. I'd also like to assure members that the proposed wording is consistent with the LGPS investment regulations regarding the suitability of particular investments and types of investments. So section 2.3 sets out the wording that is proposed. The first sentence is already contained in our investment strategy statement, and I'm looking for approval to add the wording that a fund may also make use of derivatives, either directly or in pooled investments, for the purposes of efficient portfolio management or to hedge specific risks in order to protect the value of the fund's assets. Section 3 sets out the relevant risks that, as with any insurance, equity option structures have the potential to have the effect of reducing returns in the long term, so therefore the cost, purpose and duration of these strategies should be identified clearly before they are implemented. Section 8 sets out the resource implications. The costs of the managers are set out in January's report. The design, implementation and monitoring of the strategies will require some additional officer resource, but the overlay has the potential to deliver considerable short-term benefits to employers through revised contribution rates. And those contribution rates can be revised because it gives the actuary greater certainty in terms of the assumptions that he will use for the March 2019 actuarial valuation. So the recommendation in section 13 is firstly that members note the report, approve the implementation of the overlay strategy as outlined in the Mercer report, and then secondly that members approve the revised wording for the investment strategy statement. Thank you, Chair.
So I'm going to try and put that into a couple of sentences, because so I understand what that was all about. Okay, so effectively, Merseyside Pension Fund is 100% funded, but so what does that mean? So a lot of pension schemes are not funded. So for example, it's correct me if I'm wrong, Peter, but the Teachers Pension Fund, for example, is paid for out of the Treasury pot, whereas local government pension schemes, we hold our own funds, and we have 100% of all the pension money that we need if we close the fund to pay the pensions of all members, right to the end. And that's a really enviable position to be in for a pension fund. And that's why George Osborne and all his mates looked upon our pension pots greedily, thinking, I'll have some of that. Nevertheless, they're still in local government's hands as we stand now. But obviously, for local government pension funds to be affordable means that we have to, one, keep down the employee contributions to a level that the employers, the local authorities can afford. But because we're 100% funded, we can afford to perhaps not take so many risks when we look at investments and the like. And also, it's an opportunity for us to perhaps insure against volatility in the market, the ups and downs of the market. So what we're looking at here is taking out an insurance policy to take out the peaks and troughs that we might get in the market. Is that right, Peter? I'm hoping he says yes.
Yes, that's right. We have. So hopefully the Director of Finance can confirm we have been liaising and consulting with the various Merseyside Directors of Finance as well.
So it's good as councillors for our dual responsibility when assessing budgets. One of the things we have to consider and reflect upon is obviously the cost of the scheme, the cost of the employees' contribution. So this is one of the ways we can try and keep the employers' contributions predictable and as even as possible. So when we're planning for our budgets and moving forward, we know we're going to have. So that's why we're doing this, and that's why Peter's making this recommendation. So, have we got any questions? I probably didn't need to say that today, but thank you very much, everyone. Councillor Ian.
Yeah, just, and you might have said before, it is quite daunting when you come to these meetings and hear what's being said, but I actually come on this committee because of a Friends of the Earth document that was released. Was talking about £200 million of investments in fracking from our pension fund, the WP
committees have an email exchange. With regards to the report, I can't see anything with regards to the environment or anything like that. Is there anything you can say to me, Peter, to support my mind at least with regards to that?
Well, it's not part of this particular report.
Right, isn't it?
But no, I think I think what you've got is sitting opposite you as a real ally there. So quite clearly, it's the conscience of this committee with regards to environment and green investments. So I think it's a very valid point. It's not part of this report, but what we need to do is answer any concerns that you have over fracking investments. And it's probably as well if we talk about that. In fact, we could even do a paper on that for the next pensions committee on a report back in the week. See, I don't care, would it?
Certainly, we could provide a couple of minutes of all the official confirmation as well.
So Councillor Byrne, if we come back on that one, it's not part of this particular paper, but if we come back, I appreciate your concern on that. It's certainly a concern on many members of this committee over fracking, because it affects the Wirral, particularly the west side of the Wirral, doesn't it? Going down towards Elsbury Falls and that, where they're looking into Cheshire Shop, they're looking towards Leicester. And being a Cheshire Chester resident now, I have to think about these things. So, but we'll come back on that one. So happy to accept that recommendation. Right, so Peter's going to talk us through the cooling bed. Just so as you know, just for the benefit of members here. So I mentioned briefly that George Osborne while he's term in office at over 100 local government pension schemes. He thought there was too many. Why don't we bring you all together into one big pot? And that would be more efficient, wouldn't it? And you'd be worth £280 billion, and that would really do a lot for us, whoever the government was of the day. So the recommendation of the government was that instead of perhaps coming together as one big pot, that would be too much at once, so maybe six or eight pension pools. That's where local government pension schemes come together and combine assets and try and make some savings on efficiencies and performance, and perhaps give them the opportunity to invest in infrastructure, housing and the like. So that was thrown open to the local government pension schemes throughout the country. And we now have 8 pension pools. And Merseyside Pension Fund is part of the Northern LGPS, which consists of Merseyside, Greater Manchester, and West Yorkshire Pension Fund. So this report is a little bit of feedback on where we are. But also, the government's just doing some consultation at the moment over some of the implications and what they would like us to achieve. And as part of that consultation process, we've been asked to give our views, and we don't like everything, so we've put documents together here letting the government know how we feel about some of those implications. So Peter's going to talk that through with us.
Yes, thank you, Chair. The report contains 2 appendices. The first is a draft response from the fund. An outline of the key considerations in that response is attached. And the proposal is that a more detailed response will be provided formally by the 28th. And then the second appendix is a copy of the draft response from the Northern LGPS, which is more detailed. I didn't see the purpose of, in a sense, repeating things in the Northern LGPS response from the fund, but the fund picks up some of the more detailed inconsistencies in the guidance. So in terms of the background, the government originally issued pooling guidance in November 2015. On the 3rd of January this year, the government issued new guidance which replaced the 2015 guidance and sought views on the new guidance. And as we say under section 2.2, we do have some concerns about the nature of the new guidance. It seems to lose some of the original criteria, for example, around the scale of pools, that no longer features in the new guidance. Similarly, the requirement for cost savings no longer features. So in the response from the Northern LGPS, a number of positives that the pool has achieved are highlighted around the investments we've already made structure, the investments that we're making in private equity on a pooled basis, the appointment of an FCA joint custodian for the three funds in the pool, and finally the fact that we are measuring our performance and our costs against global pension funds using CEM benchmarking. So section 2.3 sets out the concerns that we have. As I mentioned, the removal of the value for money criteria, the concerns about the fiduciary duty of members of the committee and of authorities, the suggestion that a wider duty is owed to parties other than their own funds and their own stakeholders, the requirement for pools to have an FCA regulated company at the heart of them, and then finally the nature of the consultation process and lack of guidance and the benefits of the proposals are all areas of concern to us. They're laid out in more detail in the appendix. So as I mentioned, there are two appendices. Members asked to vote the report, vote the response from the Northern LGPS that has been approved by the Shadow Joint Committee of the Northern LGPS, and I'm seeking approval for the draft response